a warm welcome from Caux to you online, and a wonderful welcome to our panel here in Caux and our panel online. We're going to have a discussion on lifelong learning for a resilient economy. And I would like to give some context to this. So resilience in this context means it's the capacity to constantly adapt to changing situations, so the capacity to change. And learning, well, we learn every day and often without noticing. And yet, sometimes life gives us an important lesson. And the COVID-19 pandemic has given us such a lesson. It has revealed our personal vulnerability, but also the vulnerability of our globalized economy towards external shocks. And this pandemic is still around, and its impact is felt across the world. And many people say, like, we have now to change. It's like a last call to change, and that we need to build a resilient economy that is kind of taking into account the people and the planet. This is what is going to make the economy resilient. But how can we do that? What do we need to learn? And also, very important, what do we have to unlearn to make that happen? And what is the role of lifelong learning in building a resilient economy? So we are going to discuss that now. We were having a first round with our six wonderful panelists, and everybody's going to give a perspective, and then we're going to have a conversation among you. And I would like to start with Daniela Castell from Digital Switzerland. You are a senior director in education and talent, and Digital Switzerland is a Swiss business network with 150 members and aiming to increase the innovation of Switzerland. And so I'd like to know from you, where is our motivation for learning coming from? What is our inner motivation, and also what do we need to learn? What are hard skills and what are soft skills? And what is more important to build a resilient economy?
So hi Annika, hi co-panelists, glad to be here today in Caux. So let me start with a quote by Einstein. Einstein says that the day you stop learning, you die. So it's kind of a grim beginning, but it's true. We learn, as you said, in every way and in many settings. We learn formally and informally. And the motivation may be intrinsic or extrinsic. And the intrinsic motivation is often stuff that you love or that you're interested in or you want to acquire. And the extrinsic motivation may be something that the employer imposes on you or that you must learn for yourself to be able to progress in your profession. If we're talking about soft skills and hard skills for a resilient economy, soft skills will be essential for tomorrow. And soft skills include creativity, they include team building, they include dialogue, communication skills, and all of these things that actually make human interaction easier and that make adaptability easier as well.
Which will make a person more resilient.
Which would make a person more resilient.
Thank you so much. So I would like to go now online to Andrea Kuttner, head of digital learning at Credit Suisse. And I would like to know from you, where does this inner motivation come from your employees in your learning program? What is motivating them, and what are you teaching them so that they can increase their resilience on the labor market?
I think we have a long tradition here, and so it's very important that we provide our people with interesting programs. I think that's something where it really starts, to provide the learning contents that people are interested in. Of course, there is, as you just said, there are some areas that are very, people are interested, that they like to learn, and others that they have to do. As you can imagine, in a bank with regulatory environment, very often we need to learn something that perhaps not everybody is very happy about. At the same time, we really try to adapt our offering that we have in leadership and professional development to regularly update it and make our learning interesting. I think another perspective that is very important here is that the managers also live the culture of learning. And this is also something that is motivating in the development of our professionals.
Thank you so much. And now I would like to go out of Europe to Ukraine. And hello, Ivan. So, Ivan, you have created, well, you're the co-founder of the education technology platform Prometheus. And it's a massive open online courses with 1 million listeners. The main objective of this platform is to provide free access to the university level of courses. So during the pandemic, 1.5 billion children around the world were out of school. And of course, it was a factor of resilience to move into the education technology, to move education online. And it definitely benefited also your company. What do you think now? Is this the future of learning? Is the whole learning going to happen online?
I think it's a really interesting question because, you know, I believe that in the future, online education will grow up absolutely, but it won't substitute offline education. I think that it will supplement offline education. And my strong belief is in few decades, we will have a classical offline education, though we will see blended learning education, right? We probably will still say offline learning, but in reality, some parts of offline learning will be supplemented by online. Okay, there is little sense to hear lectures from professor from my local university if I can hear lectures from, you know, one of the best professors from the world. But and, or for example, for teachers, it's a little sense to require students to practice assignments on paper if you can create online tests and then the system will automatically grade students, right? But on the other hand, you still need offline for small discussions, for networking, for one-on-one mentoring, etc. And I think we will need these things for many, many years. And we definitely will have a lot of blended learning education, mixed education, right? Where the best elements from online and offline will be combined and will provide the best value for students and for teachers.
So it's going to be more a blended solution. No?
Yeah.
And do you think it's important to trigger more inner motivation for online learning? I personally found it a bit difficult to sit behind a computer after work and learn something online. So some means to make it more engaging, more human maybe?
Yeah, I think actually there's a one huge advantage of online learning for inner motivation already. I think that online learning is a failure safe space because remember at school, I think it's a common experience for many people. You have a class, you have a test, and you feel stressed, you feel anxiety because you don't want to fail test, right? Because it's even if it's just practice, you will have consequences. You teacher probably will think less about you and you just don't want to fail. And sometimes you're just too tired to take a test, but you have to. And in online learning, it's just the opposite. You can fail. You can fail once, twice, again and again. And you can try assignments again and again until you succeed, right? You can try different risky approaches, innovative approaches, because there is no risk involved. And I think that it's really cool that in online education you already can be free of this anxiety. Just, you know, from personal side, a few years ago, I discovered that a lot of people have this common nightmare where they go to the classroom in their dream and they have a test and they know nothing about this subject, right? And the whole nightmare is just them sitting in the classroom and they don't know what to do. And I hope that online education can help the next generation of students and they won't have this nightmare, you know, anymore. And just a short remark about gamification. I think that, yeah, the gamification is already an important part of educational technologies. We try to do learning experience not only useful, but really fun. But on the other hand, I'm a little bit skeptical that we can fundamentally make education absolutely fun, because it's a challenge, right? To learn something challenging, difficult, you need to put a lot of effort. So yeah, we'll try our best to do it in a fun way, but by the end of the day, you still need a lot of effort to do it.
Thank you so much. And it's interesting to think that the online space is a safe space to fail. So I didn't think about that before. Thank you so much. And now, be coming back to Switzerland, to Nazrene. Nazrene Mannie, you are an executive director of the Global Apprenticeship Network GAN, which is a network of companies, employer organizations, associations, and international organizations with the mission to promote quality apprenticeships and creating job opportunities for youth and ensuring skills for business. Welcome. So I just wanted to know, this is now a very traditional way of learning. It has had like several hundred years in Europe and less around the world. And what I would find interesting, is this really suitable for the 21st century? Is it really building resilience? Is it really relevant for lifelong learning?
Thanks, Annika, and hello to you and Danielle and Naureen and to all of the participants. It's a really great privilege to be on the panel today. I think what is key is that a lot of the skills that are offered through apprenticeship courses, through different forms of work-based learning, are those skills that build resiliency, they build flexibility, they create knowledge and allow people to move through different careers, through different pathways. And what we found really interesting during this time is that many companies have found alternative ways to see how to deliver learning, blended learning, and apprenticeships, yes, have stopped. We know that there have been disruptions, and Olga can even speak to some of the research that the ILO has done in this space. But we've also seen companies really adapt and try to see how to offer a lot of these skills through different forms of learning. So the practical learning that apprenticeships are known for have now been delivered through simulations, through digital online courses. And then there have been some industries where the learning has actually continued. In fact, it's ramped up because of demand in those industries. For example, the healthcare sector. It's been fascinating to see how apprentices in hospitals are being used for their skills, are being in demand, actually, because hospitals need those essential skills. Electricians, plumbers, nurses. Doctors are a form of apprenticeships. If you look at the fact that a major part of being a doctor is the on-job training. And we know that several countries have actually accelerated their medical students and have put them in the field. So as difficult as COVID has been in terms of disruption for learning, there have been some bright spots. And I think a lot of the core fundamental skills delivered through apprenticeships and other forms of work-based learning are intrinsic to the skills we need in the future of work.
Yeah, thank you so much. And so we can say it's actually a very resilient way of learning. You're learning core skills which are transferable from one profession to the other, which is very interesting in the 21st century, where skills have to adapt all the time. Thank you so much, Nazrene. Olga. Olga Strietska-Ilina. You're working as a senior skills and employability specialist specialized on skills strategies for future labor markets for the International Labour Organization, which is a United Nations agency whose mandate is to advance social and economic justice through setting international labor standards. And we talked before this, and you told me that the UNESCO and the World Bank have come up with a new study regarding the impact of COVID-19 on the provision of vocational training and lifelong learning. Could you tell us a little bit about this impact?
Thank you very much, Annika, and good afternoon, everybody. Thank you also for inviting the ILO to this very interesting discussion. Let me maybe start from a little bit of a context from the point of view of the world of work. We know, based on recent ILO estimates, that actually around 94% of world workers found themselves in some kind of situation of closures of workplaces. And that has an impact. That has obviously an impact also on the loss of working hours. That translates also in the loss of full-time jobs equivalent of now calculated of 305, which is really enormous. And that potentially may lead to major loss in employment and structural changes. Of course, in this context, learning, and especially lifelong learning at any point in time, becomes exceptionally important. At the same time, what we also saw that overnight, we all had to become teleworkers to basically take our things and go to home and work from home as intensively as we did in the office. And the same happened to learning. So overnight, also, the change happened to training providers. And indeed, we implemented the survey together with UNESCO and the World Bank. We're still working on the final report, but the preliminary results, I can tell you that, of course, as in the world of work, also the change and this transition to teleworking did not affect everybody equally. We know that, for example, people in an informal economy are affected much more because they did not have any social coverage and they literally lost their income opportunity, that young people happen to be overrepresented in informal jobs and also in sectors which are affected. Older workers were exposed to technologies and was not also easy. Women, there is a massive return of migrant workers. And the same we also saw that happened in this learning. So we know that 98%, which is almost 100%, 98% of respondents to the survey said that their training had to shut down, either partially or fully. And basically what happened is that two-thirds of that became a distant learning. Distant learning doesn't mean online. And it's only around every second training provider that switched to online learning. And this is actually remarkable. So basically the COVID-19 accelerated the digitalization and the change affecting also the education providers and training providers. We know that before the COVID-19, only 1 in 5 of those organizations indicated that they provided some kind of online learning. Now it's every second. It's enormous. But we know that in low-income countries, especially in Africa, training providers' closure, schools closure, university closure, meant a complete closure. That means that they couldn't really transfer their learning online in most cases because of the poor connectivity, because of the poor access to infrastructure, digital infrastructure. And therefore, countries were looking for some innovation. Some of them provided learning through television. Some of them provided through radio. Some of them provided through texts circulated through postal services. So we've seen that there is quite a lot of innovation. So we have to think of lifelong learning, not only digital learning. Of course, digital provides enormous opportunities, but also there are challenges. We know that the effect, of course, on low-income countries, developing countries, was much more, but also it was not equally distributed, so poor households were affected more. Young women or girls were affected more because they were expected actually to take some responsibilities at home. Also what we found out that it is important to not just to rely on one form of learning, but also to remember that actually schools and training centers, they provide important point for interaction. So therefore they're important for socio-emotional development of people and especially young people. Therefore, I don't think we can really say that even though the COVID-19 accelerated that change, that there were only positive elements. We also know that practical training was enormously affected, or work-based learning. There was 9 in 10 workers, basically, apprentices, were affected by a loss of opportunity of training. So maybe this is for the beginning, and then we can say a little bit more.
Thank you so much, Olga. Yeah. Thank you so much, Olga. That's very interesting. And it's interesting to point out that the resilience of online teaching and online working actually is context linked. I mean, you have to have the infrastructure, you have to have the connectivity. So it is not necessarily for everybody the case. And in this situation, it can even be like a factor of exclusion, deepen the digital divide. So, we haven't talked to you yet, Nora. Naureen, Nayyar. So you are now a tech advisor, and I would like to know from you, in your opinion, what are the key skills in the 21st century to build a resilient employability? A resilient employability, like what are the key skills? What is
professional skills?
Yeah.
So I'm a product consultant and a tech consultant, and it's been really interesting to think about that from a product point and where professional companies are looking. I think that today the skills we need for lifelong learning specifically, is that what you're asking?
Yeah,
are, I think, much more about the, as you were saying, it's more about the soft skills more than ever before. Because even if you have the technical skills, so much of this digital world that we're entering and this, you know, future AI and all this, it's going to be all about our intuition as people. And I think we're going to redefine all this language. I think we're not going to have this language of hard or soft skills. It's going to be human skills. And then, you know, what are the deep human skills we need to go forward professionally? How do we develop professionally the understanding of team building, not just in a physical place, but distributed teams or blended, you know, online learning or blended. And it's also about, I think, technology. You know, I think, you know, for me, people, because you're building products for, you know, leaders, you're building products for consumers, and you're building people with different learning mechanisms. So we have, people who are visual learners, we have people who are more auditory learners, then we have a blended, and then we have people who need some sort of feel touch in order to get an understanding, because that's what their profession requires. As Olga, I think, was mentioning in regards to, for example, the medical field, you know, or I think it was actually perhaps Nazrene that mentioned apprenticeship, you know, in those fields, of course, digital learning will be a different experience, because there's a level of, for a surgeon to have that capacity. We provide already these kind of digital spaces where you can learn surgery, but I think there's a level of certain people that need to feel that, like the touch of scissors or whatever, for getting that information. And so I think it's two sides. As a person developing products, the professional experience you'll need is to know that you're gonna have multifaceted, we can expand now. We know now that people don't learn one way. Mm-hmm. So let's not say someone is not able to learn. They're just not able to learn perhaps this way. So how do we engage them? And then we also know that we're in different emotional levels. How do we build empathetic products? So it's an inner dialogue with yourself and the company. Say, how do we build empathetic products that think about different age variants, different life skills, different emotional imbalances, and then also then in regards to users, you know, consumers and people who are going to use those products, it's about what is your time? How are you going to manage that time to understand what you need for those skills to develop? I think learning itself is going to expand, but also in that expansion, we're seeing a need for people to have the ability to have quiet time, as we say in, you know, to have that time to actually reflect a little bit about, are you working on learning in a way that's emotionally good for you? You know, is 8 hours online going to be sustaining you as a teacher or a student? You know, so there's a level of the skills that are more about like also understanding where to say no, because when we start, you know, if you look at Charlie Chaplin days, you know, the factory worker, the children labor, that whole era of industrial revolution, it required people to say, wait a second, the factory work and these children working, this isn't working. So there's always going to be a need for us as humans to also have that component of understanding accountability as an individual and a collective on, is this the right way to learn? Because I don't believe all of us who are making technology know what we're doing. I don't believe we're making the right decisions all the time. And we need to be accountable. And that requires also a consumer group that has the intuition and all that. I think that is more important than anything, because even if you have the technology skills on everything, that doesn't mean you're building the healthiest product. Definitely. For humanity.
Yeah. Thank you so much, Nora. Thanks. So in the digital age, we actually need much more human skills.
Absolutely.
And we have to be very intentional about lifelong learning. So when someone is born, does this person now need a lifelong learning passport, and then it's validated all the time what this person has learned throughout life, and what are we going to learn during retirement? Is it stopped before retirement, or what are the necessary skills? I put that out, if someone wants to comment on that. Danièle?
So I would strongly recommend not developing a lifelong learning passport because it's too constraining, and learning should remain a pleasure, even if it's a necessity in some cases. So school might be a necessity, apprenticeships like Nazrene was talking about might be a necessity, or other forms of learning might be a necessity. It starts from the cradle and it goes to the grave. So learning never stops, actually. And one of the discussions in the learning area is, particularly in Switzerland, which is very focused on certificates, is do you really need certificates to show that you've learned? Because, you know, in the case of learning on the job that Nazrene knows tons about, you know, you learn on the job, you don't need a certificate, they're transferable skills. So to have a passport is to reinforce the idea of certificate when the market is going in a completely different way.
Yeah, that's true. Yeah. Was someone having a different opinion on this? Nazrene?
Thank you, Annika. I think to echo what Danielle is saying, a lot of learning has to be self-driven, even within the constraints of it being necessary. And I think the idea of a passport has a place in certain times where you need to bank your skills. So as you move through the labor market, perhaps you need to demonstrate you have the necessary level of quality, or you have achieved the relevant skills for the job at hand. But I think throughout life, and especially if the new generation is going to live to 100 years or more, I don't think we need to be so bureaucratic or compliant. But I do think there's a place for quality learning. And I do think there's a place for the quality assurance of learning, but at different points in our lives. Thank you.
And Olga, you wanted to say something?
And there is a compulsory learning, which is very important. Of course, it's a challenge to make any learning a pleasure, which is kind of a didactical challenge. However, it is true that a lot of learning happens informally. So that's why we speak not only about lifelong learning, but also we speak about life-wide learning, recognizing all forms of learning, including informal and non-formal. But then what will happen to individuals who attain skills? Imagine you receive an education as an economist, and you happen to work all your life as a florist or hairdresser or anyone, or it could be another higher education type of specialization. You would like to move from one employer to another, and your qualification becomes really important. So for the employability of individuals, having a certificate is actually quite important. And also, there is what happens on the labor market, there is a lot of skills not really recognized and not really utilized. So very often we hear complaints about skill shortages, and then if you actually look into the availability of those skills and people who completed certain type of education, you actually find out that they are not utilized at the appropriate level, so people are not really working at their full productive potential. In order to avoid that, it's also important to have some kind of a provision that would allow individuals to go through the assessment process and encourage them to develop further their learning. And for this, we need also to recognize their skills, either now it's a full qualification or partial qualification. At the same time, I agree with you that in future, qualifications in the way we are used to them will be meaning less than now. And perhaps what is going to happen, it's more diversification of the types of certificates, of the types of qualifications, credits, partial qualifications, multiple credits, where individual will become much more an owner of his or her, not only career, but also composition of these micro qualifications to basically create his own qualification profile. And for this, we need to make sure that individuals can go through the systems of assessment, recognition of skills, and certification. That also applies to digital learning, informal learning as well.
Yeah, thank you so much. And I just wondered, even in Ukraine, you said the government has created like a validation for online teaching.
Yes, so it's a really interesting case. So in Ukraine, teachers mandated by the government to get some fixed amount of hours of training to improve their skills. And this year, the government started to recognize third-party providers of such certificates. So, for example, a teacher can choose Prometheus online course, get certificate, and then the government will recognize this certificate from online course as the official professional training of this teacher, right? And just I think that other countries can try the same system, but I also can add something to the general discussion about lifelong learning passport. I think that it's a great idea in theory, but there is a huge obstacle in practice, because to create some, you know, there are already different diplomas, micro credentials from mainstream of online courses, certificates, etc. But to create one ultimate, you know, lifelong learning passport, you need to define carefully and very precise each skill of humankind. And it's extremely challenging to do, right? Especially because there is a lot of potential discussion, like, what is a critical thinking? It's not a one skill, right? It's a number of different skills. So part logic, part statistical reasoning, part identifying bias, etc. But each of these parts is always also a number, a collection of different sub-skills, etc. So I think it's a cool idea in general, but it's really, really challenging to implement it technically.
Yeah, thank you so much. And I would like to have Andrea's opinion on burden sharing of lifelong learning, because lifelong learning means we learn all the time, but there are moments in life where we have a family or we are studying as well or something else. Oh, this doesn't work, but when you are very, very much occupied with something else and you're supposed to learn all the time, and your finances maybe also goes rather in your children who are starting university. So how are you supposed to learn all the time, and whose responsibility is it to take on this journey of learning? Is it more the employee, the employer?
Well, I think at the moment in Credit Suisse, we are really launching very interesting initiatives to create a culture of lifelong learning. I think it depends really on how learning is viewed in a company. So it starts with questions, when do I learn? Do I learn during my working hours, or do I learn at the weekend because I have a bad conscience if I'm learning during my working hours normally? And these are really big questions that need to be answered to give the comfort to the organization. Now, in terms of responsibility, who's responsible for learning, we think it's really the responsibility of the individual. I had a colleague, and he talked to me, and he said he's now in Credit Suisse for 7 years, and he never had a training or an education. So I thought, oh my God, I mean, there are so many opportunities, you know, so you just have to stand up and take the opportunity. Secondly, if you talk about timing, do I have the time? And there are other topics always around. I think we need to take the time. And if we see from the culture, and also, let's say, from our development plans that we have, that is very important in Credit Suisse, that we develop our people, that we support them to show the areas and potential gaps they might have, and that we are supporting to fill them, then we can make sure that everybody takes the opportunity.
Yeah, thank you so much. And here's a question from our online audience. How to introduce lifelong learning to older generations who are not digitally savvy?
I'd love to connect with that. I think when you say older generations, we're also talking about people who are just learning also to go online. It's the same kind of challenges in some ways, because it's new information. And just like any other new information, it requires a little bit of instructional understanding. And understanding, again, earlier I said that curiosity and openness are very important, and that's an ageless desire to be open and curious, and it's always having allies in those subgroups. So whether it's older people or people entering the internet, it's all about, that's where the community part and having people you trust. Because our openness to information has so much to do with how we are open to the people sharing information. And that's why sometimes we have teachers we enjoy and teachers we don't, and they could both be great teachers, but sometimes it's a very human psychological thing. So it's about connecting to the needs of safety. So I think that's why the thing we've seen with, I have some friends who've worked with actually in this creating products for seniors to understand things around dementia actually, and these kind of games online that they could use on iPads in senior living homes. And these individuals had never used technology at all. But just to have, for example, these younger people, so they had these volunteers come in that were like the same age as their grandkids. And it was just, there was this opportunity to actually just engage with someone. And it just, to them, this was a new opportunity to connect and to feel warm, to feel like they matter. So this is one of the biggest challenges you see with elderly communities and so forth, is the need to feel belonging, safety, connectedness. And so if you can connect with that, I think it opens up again the curiosity and openness to whatever you want to share. Yeah.
Yeah, and it shows also it needs emotions, positive emotions.
Absolutely.
To learn, actually. Yeah. And Nazrene, how is it now with apprenticeship? This is normally for young people, but do we also find elder generations doing this?
Speaking about people older than 25 or 30, and in fact in the UK, which has a very strong, very formal skills development system, and government has in place a number of incentives for employers to do apprenticeships, the vast majority of apprenticeships are going towards older workers. And I think part of the reason is because of the impending uncertainty around the future of work, changing technologies coming into the workplace, and there's a very real need to upskill existing workforces. It's important to make sure that people who... Apologies for the feedback. It's important to make sure that people are using the skills that they have, that they can build on those skills, knowledge and experience, that they can move to higher level training and development. And then to see how these individuals can ensure that they formalize the skills development process, so they're doing proper apprenticeships where they will get a trade certificate at the end of it. And I think that's something that's picking up across the world. And in fact, when GAN started, our mandate was skills development through apprenticeships for youth, transitions to the workplace for young people. And within a matter of a few years, we realized that actually we can't marginalize people across the workforce, because everyone needs a fair chance to be able to adapt, upskill, reskill, and learn new skills. So I think there's an overwhelming trend now towards apprenticeships across the age groups.
Yeah, thank you so much. I have here a very interesting question from the audience. Can there be a negative side to lifelong learning? Could it lead to devaluing certain professions, also lead to exclusion? And how to work on that? Yeah, look at you, Danielle.
So the short answer is yes, I believe it could. Let me give you a concrete example. One of the companies that I've had occasion to see is now pushing the onus entirely onto employees through artificial intelligence technology, which can identify what skill sets. So you go through a taxonomy of skill sets in this company, and then it provides a profile for you, and you either have to opt in or opt out of the training. The assumption behind it is that everyone will opt in, but not everyone wants to learn. And not everyone wants to learn those particular skills. In other words, if we're talking about, I don't know, using Zoom, I may prefer to go and look and learn Teams, for example. And so these systems, which are very, very powerful, very complete, can create a phenomenon of pressure whereby if you don't opt in, basically you're not on a fast track career or even on a career track. And I think that's terribly dangerous. And so to Andrea's point about whether it was the employer or the employee, I actually think it's a shared responsibility to make sure that people aren't left out.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, especially normally very well-trained people become more trained in the end. So. Yes, thank you so much. And then I have another question. What are the skills, how can we actually learn to change? Because what I found very interesting during the COVID pandemic was that we saw also very positive images of people who were supporting each other. We had people volunteering to help. We had this creativity in Italy from people entertaining each other from the balconies. And this way they created resilient networks. And I kind of felt like, well, can one be very intentional about this? Could we teach that maybe in school or in business trainings? These values of empathy, can you train that really? Who wants to go on that?
Empathy, and interesting enough, I was just discussing it yesterday with a friend of mine, and we realized that it's also kind to develop the empathy is a part of the development of the personality, but it's also not learning facts and figures to really get that, but learn about different people, about psychology, about the different styles people have, and understand these different styles. And by understanding these styles and also reflect yourself what kind of style you are having, and that you can adapt to other styles to make people more comfortable. And I think this is this kind of background knowledge is not directly empathy, but if you have this kind of background knowledge, you learn or you provide and you show empathy in your environment.
Yeah, thank you, Andrea. And there's also the question of role models and behavioral change, and are you at initiatives of change? And we like to inspire people with personal stories of change. And what do you think about? How can you learn through role models? Because now it has been very about technical approach, and I would like to know the other way of learning is following people, example. Oh. You want to come in again, Andrea?
Yes. Yeah, I think as I just told you, we do have this initiative in Credit Suisse. We are launching actually Degreed, and we are very excited about it. And one very important functionality is really to look into my peers or into other people that I think they're doing a great job, or I'm interested in, or they are kind of a role model for myself. So I can really see what kind of areas they are covering, what they are learning. And so it's kind of a peer comparison, or a comparison of what my role models do. And then I can go the same pathways.
Thank you. Danièle, you want to say something as
yeah,
well?
Yeah, I think mentors can also play. So Andrea was talking about peer-to-peer, mm. But I think mentors can help. When I was working in a multinational, I was mentored by a very senior manager, and I learned so much. And whilst we were in different roles and in different hierarchies of the corporation, because this person took the time to discuss things with me, storytell with me, show me ways, show me alternatives, show me how the company could teach me. It was really, really a milestone for me. So I think mentors are, role model has a particular significance to it, but I think mentors can also be incredibly useful inside the company, outside the company, in life.
Yeah, yes. So it's this mix actually which is needed. And the personal relationship as well probably is very important in that. Does someone else want to come in this question?
Is there anyone else?
Maybe Nazrene?
Yeah. I think just to say that what GAN does when we started was this idea of model behavior is really important. So we've done two things. One is the peer-to-peer learning, so similar to what Andrea spoke about, but across different organizations. So we bring our company partners to share the experiences. And what we found is that many companies, irrespective of the sector they operate in, actually have shared experiences and shared challenges, particularly around talent development. Mm. So they're learning from each other. The other side is CEO leadership. And it's very similar to the mentorship issue, because we also realize that CEOs speak at a different level, they engage in different conversations and different kinds of conversations, and they learning from each other. So it's exciting to see the openness to learning, the willingness to learn. And I think that also links to the issue of unlearning. And I think this issue of being open and willing to acknowledge where you can improve is important. And then the other issue around empathy and those soft skills, and I don't particularly like the word soft skills because we tend to undervalue it when we talk. But I think it's these foundational skills that are core. And it has to start, one, in the home, and two, through the education journey, so from childhood, to really improve the experience.
Yeah, thank you. Olga, would you come in shortly, please?
I simply wanted to remind that when we speak about lifelong learning, it's really from cradle to grave, and a lot of what will happen later on is actually programmed at this early stage. So Andrea mentioned, for example, an employee who never was trained. Can you imagine if this employee had a really bad experience of education, his initial education, why would he ever want to learn again? So basically, a lot of what happens at an early stage then programs the individual's motivation to learn. And it is also important to understand that a lot of core employability skills, as we call them, not just soft skills, but core employability skills, such as collaboration, communication, teamwork, including empathy, including some resilience skills now, creative thinking, innovation. This happens through way we learn. It's not necessarily that someone actually comes and teaches you, but actually the way you learn. So if you work in team, you learn the teamwork. It's not that they are taught about teamwork. This is the example. And the fact is that the best way to teach those skills is as in the early childhood rather than adult people. It's almost too late to try to teach them that. Not impossible, but much harder.
Yeah, thank you, Olga. Do you want to come on the topic of unlearning, Daniela, because you were reacting to it?
I think that you several people mentioned unlearning, and I think it's really important in today's world. It doesn't mean forgetting what you've learned, but it means unlearning certain behaviors or certain habits or certain ways of approaching things. And I think that's really important as you progress in a career. It's important from the word go, in fact. You know, you learn maths. How much of the maths that you learn do you actually apply? It's somewhere at the back of your mind, but if you're not working in a mathematical environment, the chances are that you'll have stored the knowledge somewhere that you can retrieve, but you're not actually using it. So the notion of unlearning, I think, is part of today's resilience as well.
Mm-hmm. But it's a very provocative way, because you need to be humble and say, well, I have a beginner's mind now, and I'm going to be like a young child in school and try to not knowing and to be open for something new. I think that is also something we have to be taught.
I want to add a thing I was thinking of with regards to unlearning. One of the things I went to Hyper Island where I studied interactive art direction, and one of the things my teacher said is the idea of also blind spots. I think when you have this relationship where you get a mentor or connect with your colleagues, especially this is why right now, I mean, on the media, there's a conversation about inclusivity and having diverse groups. I think it's about cognitive diversity and international diversity, especially because we all have our individual blind spots when we live in our bubbles of people that are like-minded. And I think that's also the thing. It's like unlearning the things about us, like Olga was mentioning, of our childhood learnings that maybe we held back because we didn't have the right teachers or whatnot, but also this idea of understanding in the future how perhaps because we grew up in this one community and then we go off to build global products or be with global-minded people, how do we connect with each other and have this relationship building to understand each other's different views and different languages?
Yeah, true. Thank you. I have another question from the online audience. So, how can we ensure future humans have enough emotional intelligence? If all training digital, don't we miss human cues? So, someone wants to come in, please. Andrea?
Digital is great, but it needs to be really a blended learning to really pick the right approach of learning, be it a conference like we have it today, or be it just a web-based training, or be it a platform where we discuss a certain topic, but then also face-to-face training. And the interaction of the human being is not disappearing. I think we need to be careful with it and just use it in the best way. But there are some learning contents that need to be still individual. And so I think this could be a place as well for individual interaction.
Yeah, thank you so much, Andrea. Someone else wants to come on the same question?
Happy to say something.
Say something.
I fully concur with what Andrea said. I don't think that in future all lifelong learning will be online. We will still have human interactions. I know that there's a lot of fear in the market globally about how machines may take over, but that's not a reality. It won't be a reality for a long time. It may never be a reality. And therefore, human interaction is really, really important. And so for those who are fearful that everything will go online, I really concur. I think that there will be blended learning. People need contact, they need socialization, they need the emotional relationships and the connection, and I would like to give a message of hope here.
Yeah, and I totally agree too, because COVID-19 also taught us, well, how much we miss each other.
Totally.
How much we miss to be
close to each
other. That's
why I came here, to be close to you.
Yeah, so we have to acknowledge that. So at Initiatives of Change, we like to make a quiet moment. And as we had now a lot of information exchanges, I would just allow now for 30 seconds where we kind of just think about what we've heard from each other, and then we restart the conversation. Thank you. So someone had a special thought, then you have the floor to share that now. You're welcome.
So just on the theme that we were just talking about, I think there's another element that was picked up notably by Olga, which is infrastructure. And many countries don't have the infrastructure. And one of the lovely stories that came out during COVID was the story of a camel library. So in places where there are no libraries, a gentleman with a camel takes books round to the villages. And so I just think that human contact is important.
Yeah, I think many of us agree on that. So here's another question from the audience. How to train people about managing together ecological and digital transition? And I think that's a very interesting topic, because there's a lot about digital skills, but we want to have a climate-resilient economy, so we need a green economy, and the green economy needs certain skills. So how can we develop these skills? And we are lucky that Olga is with us, because she's a specialist in this topic. Olga, would you like to share some insights?
It's important to think about the green economy as an opportunity, especially now in the context of the recovery from the COVID-19. There will be, and there are already some fiscal recovery packages put together targeting specific sectors. So many countries will target, and they are targeting already, green jobs, environmental sustainability, also taking into account the commitments they have to the Paris Agreement since 2015. And it's a good sign, of course, because we know from our research that actually green economy will provide a lot of new job opportunities. And overall employment change looks really quite positive, with a high turnover, although. And therefore, we know, I don't want to go into too much of technical details here, but I can tell you that depending on the scenario, there could be between 70 there could be around 100 million jobs created. That would be just simple to say that. However, we may also lose a lot of jobs, and some of that jobs are can be replaced by people in the same occupation. Moving them from industries that are losing jobs to those industries that will be gaining jobs as a result of investment into the green economy, but some of those jobs cannot be just relocated like that. There will be the need to retrain people from one occupation to another in order not to lose these jobs and to avoid unemployment or growing unemployment in the future. And when we talk about this situation, it will actually affect more men than women, because men are also benefiting more from green jobs now, and they are benefiting more from green training as well. And this will also affect more people in middle-skill occupations. So if we want women also to benefit from this transition, and men to be less a victim of such a transition, we actually need to train also women in vocation education training type of skills that may allow them to access green jobs. And we're speaking about construction workers, workers in manufacturing and transport, sales workers, skilled agricultural workers, engineers, of course, technicians, assemblers, plumbers. So it's not just the knowledge about environment, not environmental awareness, but actually many more professions which are affected by this change. And we know from our research that what is important is actually to provide people with transferable skills. So this is the term which I would like to underline. Transferable doesn't mean only soft. And I think somebody already mentioned soft doesn't really give justice, and I agree. So we call them core employability skills, but it's not only that. There are also other types of transferable skills, such as technical, which means engineering or plumbing or maintenance, repair, allowing people in these occupations to move from one job to another and successfully implement their technical tasks, because technical tasks are not less important than core work skills or soft skills. Then semi-technical as well, such as budgeting, scheduling, marketing, as well as soft skills, which we already mentioned, including also digital skills, occupation safety and health, and as well as strategic leadership, which without this we will not make actually the green transition happen at all. In the ILO, we use the term just transition when we speak about the transition to environmental sustainability, underlining the importance of combining different types of measures on education training sites, active labor market policies, social protection, and so on, so that we ensure that there is no one left behind, and that actually is inclusive also for women, for young generation, as well as older workers.
Yeah, thank you so much, Olga. And I heard also that Ivan wants to come in. Ivan, you wanted to share something?
Actually, I wanted to comment on one particular issue. Unlearning and you know, soft skills training, because I think it's extremely important one. And during this pandemic, we saw already why it's so important. I remember when World Health Organization advised like common citizens do not wear masks because they don't need them, because obviously they didn't have a lot of enough, I would say, masks for health workers, and they wanted to save masks for health workers, and it was a right strategy. But now we have more than enough masks. World Health Organization recommends everybody to wear masks, but people just get used not to do it during the first months of pandemics, and you know, it's really challenging to unlearn. And it's a question of life and death, literally, but people can't unlearn quickly and rapidly. And just a short comment about soft skills training. I think it's almost impossible to intentionally teach critical thinking, empathy, but we can create an environment where people have to learn, students have to learn empathy, or let's say critical thinking, or learning how to learn independently to succeed. Because if at school environment you need to cooperate to succeed academically, people will learn how to have an empathy, because any other way they will fail. Or, for example, if we force people to learn that the truth, scientific truth, evolves, right? It changes over time, and you need to adapt. Then people will learn how to unlearn and will use it after school. But if we can provide this environment at school, at university, I think it won't be possible to teach people these skills just in one, you know, subject.
Thank you so much. So I just want to come to Nazrene, if you would like to share something on upskilling and reskilling.
Thank you, Annika. I think these have become central tenets of how we approach learning now. And in fact, when the GAN speaks about sustainable development, we speak about sustainable development and inclusivity in the context of learning. Because I think if we can approach it from an upskilling and reskilling methodology, then we won't have these separate dichotomies of ecological transition and digital skilling and the range of new technologies that are emerging. We will see them as integrated. And I think key to the issue also is we need to move people into more higher skilled or better skilled roles. We've seen some of the figures around the future of work and the potential impact on the workforce, particularly those who have lower level skills. You know, I don't want to say blue collar, but that's, you know, what the research tends to point to. So how do we move people through skilling to ensure that their knowledge and experience can be enhanced so that they can remain economically active, they can become and continue to be pillars within the community? I think the other issue around upskilling, reskilling and new skilling is driving this passion for upskilling, for learning new skills and for being willing to reskill yourself. In our day-to-day lives, and Ivan made this really important point now about the shift during COVID, we've had to learn so many new skills and habits in the last 3 months that we probably didn't anticipate if we spoke to each other in January. So it, again, that flexibility and willingness to learn, it's having the systems in place, very important, and Andrea has spoken to this as well. You do need that enabling environment, and that's a lot of the work of what GAN does with our partners. How do we create the right policy environment? How do we create the right structures for peer engagement? How do we create the appropriate methodology so that people can learn in a safe space, they're not threatened, but also at their own pace? And I think we're seeing in the last few months different technologies coming to the forefront. I think a lot of these technologies have always been there, we've just not used them appropriately. And I think there are lots of opportunities now to find different ways to skill. But we need to ensure that there is the structure in place, there's the access to learning. Even where people may not be competent digitally, there are different ways to learn. How do we encourage it and how do we make this mainstream?
Yes, that's true. Thank you so much. So before we start with our lessons learned, I just want to take up a point from the audience, which I found very interesting. And this is about the security, safety and transparency. So Ivan told us, well, it's a safe space to fail, but there's also another issue to online learning is that it's a place where data can be collected. It's about private data. How is it secured? Now my primary school records are at home. Nobody knows about my performance, but this changes now, especially since the start of COVID-19. So if schooling is happening online, what kind of safety measures and also digital ethics are needed to manage that? You would like to come on that?
Yes, definitely.
Nora.
I would love to talk about that because I think that's it's something that I'm very passionate about, and I really want to stress that with people, educators, you know, purchasers of all products, anyone who's going digital, who's thinking that. First, I want to start with the foundation. I think that Danielle said it, life learning happens from when you're born onwards. We're life learners. So let's make sure that we recognize that, let's not make life learning a thing that we like close to to a certification or close into a system, make it systemic, where it's, where you're in a paywall system, and if you're not inside of this digital paywall, like almost like going back to the days of being, you know, with having clerics and peasants, and you know, only 1% that owns all of the area, that that we can create that if we don't. We need to be aware that we need to make sure that learning is accessible beyond digital, and as Nazrene said, like a blended opportunity for people. That's one thing. It's that, first of all, the policies, the government has to be aware that it's not just about getting people online, but to do it the right way. And we're seeing a lot of pushback to things in the EU. So, for example, I think I mentioned this. I was consulting with an individual who was the Facebook whistleblower for Cambridge Analytica. So that's what he's been fighting for in regards to understanding the privacy rights of people as individuals and also of us in nations to protect our data. And doing work in the certain countries in regards to health data products, I've learned a lot about how governments manage your health data. And so it's very important, I think, as individuals to understand and be educated in digital literacy. So in regards to additional information that we need in regards to our, the future of life learners, I think we need to start early on with children in understanding the digital ramifications of what you put on the internet, what you put on about yourself, how we're dealing with our digital information. And it's very important. One organization I recommend is Electronic Frontier Foundation, EFF.org, I believe, that you can check out. They have a lot of great information. I actually am an avid volunteer with Wikipedia's Wikimania conference. And in that conference, we actually discuss a lot about the open data world and why are we working to have accessibility of the Wikipedia to everyone. And yes, there's a lot of challenges with the editing and all that, but the thing is that we want to make sure that accessibility does not become a thing that only Facebook, Google, and Microsoft and all these individuals who are now taking over and privatizing our learning in some ways only own, because we have public schools, and now the public schools are connected to private systems. So we need to really think about that. And I may sound a little bit like urgent stress, but it is, because we're right now in a point in the world where this, the COVID times, is creating a shift in policy, and sometimes not for the positive. So we need to be aware of, are we giving the accessibility to these big giant tech companies in a way that's going to be good for not just our learning, but the future of our rights as people?
Yeah, yeah. It made us rush into something, maybe not really understand all
Absolutely.
The ramifications. That's true. So now it's time for the lessons learned.
Andrea,
I didn't see Andrea, you would like to come into it.
Yes, I wanted to add on what was just said, which is really very interesting. So thank you very much for that insight. But I think especially on the data, there are three levels. And first of all is really the technical level. And there is a huge possibility nowadays to really share data about skills, what people have, especially on a company level, to see, do we have the right skills for the future and how do we want to use them? And then a second level is the data protection. So is the legal side of how much data can we just share and make it transparent to our to the boss or to the organization. And the third level would be really the personal preferences. Do I want to share the data across the organization or not? And I think with the data, we need to look always into these three levels of data management.
Yeah, that's true.
Great.
Thank
Great
you so much.
Yeah. Super, I agree.
So we have another question from the online audience. I just read it out. In my career, I have seen common resistance to change, learning, unlearning. What are the panelists' experience in this context? Yeah. You can go now, Andrea, and then Danielle.
Yeah. Sorry, I really had a very very interesting experience when I went through an education in change management, and I was also looking, of course, into projects that I implemented. And projects is always requires when you implement a process or a new system, requires a change in behavior. So there's always a part of training. And what we really do in banking very often is we train the technical pieces, the facts and the figures, and then we control and then we kind of punish. So this is a little bit the old world. But what I realized, what is so important to really win, and this was said before, to win the hearts of the people and to provide the reason why. Why are we learning this? Why is it so important to know the regulatory rules? Why is it so important to learn how the new systems work and the new platforms, to be not to be lost in the further development of the future? So the reason why is very, very important for me to provide that, because not everybody has this curiosity and the energy to learn all the time, and in addition to the job. Reason why is very important from my experience.
Yeah, I totally agree with you, yes. And Danièle, would you like to come there?
Just quickly, I think there are two main points here. One is communication. So to Andrea's point about change management, an integral part of change management is communication, clear communications, value-based communications. And I think the other point is simulation. So when computers first started appearing before overall digitalization happened, in Switzerland there was a small outfit called the CCSO, and they realized that there was a lot of resistance against learning and a lot of resistance against actually using the tools. And so they examined the processes in companies and then put people in simulations so that they could see where the blockages were and how the team could solve the blockages. So I think it's a combination of values, the why, the how, and the what.
And then we have also the when and the where.
Yeah.
Because now we are very flexible and can learn wherever we want and when we want. So, well, we have talked a lot about learning, but what did you learn now? This would be interesting. What is the lesson you learned during this conversation? Someone wants to jump in?
Maybe Ivan.
You can go.
I'm curious what Ivan has to say, because I've only been looking at his frozen face, and I thought maybe he had something to add. Ivan.
Yvonne, would you like to go? What did you learn from this conversation?
Yeah, I think one thing that I definitely learned that we probably need to think about future of education and education in general from many different angles. I mean, we discussed education in an aspect of infrastructure, hard skills, soft skills, learning, unlearning, inclusivity, and a lot of different aspects. And it's all very important. And one thing that I really think that we probably need to understand that education is so complex, is so challenging topic to reform, that we probably shouldn't expect any simple solutions in short terms, but we definitely need to work to do it better, to provide more educational value for students, for parents, and help teachers to do their jobs. So this is it probably from my side.
Thank you so much. Yeah. Someone else wants to come in? What have you learned during this conversation?
So I'd like to pick up on a word that Olga used called life-wide learning, and I love that. It's not just lifelong, but it's also life-wide. I think that's super inclusive, and I shall adopt that terminology.
Mm-hmm. True, me too. Nazrene? Yes, Nazrene, you can go.
I think it's been such an insightful 1 hour plus, but the main thing is that there's so much going on, and I think there's so much passion around us, and so many organizations are trying to make a change. Perhaps the one key out of here is how do we collaborate further, because we really need to work together to be that change that we want to happen.
Yes, thank you. And someone else changing some last and exchanging on some learnings? Olga?
Yes, thank you, Annika. Yeah, it's been a very interesting conversation. I guess I have maybe one learning point and a couple of discovery points. The learning point for me is that really the whole digital learning market became such a huge notion, and it's really a market with all the flaws and challenges behind it. And I think we're only starting sorting out what they are with, you know, the data security issue, quality issue, how to, and consequences. So I think there is a huge work to be done there. And a couple of discoveries. One, I think, is linked to the discussion about the learning market. I did not expect, actually, that lifelong learning is so much associated with digital learning. For me, these are different things, because for me, digital learning is one of means of learning in general. Lifelong, at any point in time, could be initial, could be continuing, doesn't matter. It's a means of achieving a certain knowledge or skill. However, I noticed that since this question appears and it's being asked, and for many people, there is an assumption that digital learning may overtake completely the learning space in the future. I think it's a worrying sign, and I think we really need to underline the role of teachers, the role of masters of this social interaction in the learning space with other peer learners. What happens actually in the education and training centers themselves, and the role of blended as well face-to-face learning. So this has been a discovery for me. And another discovery for me was that we're still discussing whose responsibility it is, because I thought we have discussed it so many times, and I thought there was kind of agreement that learning is a shared responsibility, because eventually everybody benefits from learning, not only the individual, but also it's an employer who benefits from learning of an individual because he increases productivity. It's the society who also benefits from learning of individuals, because eventually it adds value to economy and society. But somehow we're still asking, is it an individual who has to take the charge? And I think it's important to underline that from the ILO point of view, it is definitely a shared responsibility. We actually are talking about giving a right of learning to people, but for this we also need financial incentives. We need much more coordination and collaboration between different institutions. And we need also to combine different types of funding, private funding, public funding, from individuals, from employers, into some kind of assistance that would allow individuals to participate in training at any point in their lifetime, and in any type of training as well. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you so much, Olga.
Can I add? Quickly. Yeah, I will just add a quick thought. I think that one, I also had a discovery. I was thinking about the word blended. We all used it. And this past week, when I decided to come to Switzerland from Sweden, I decided between my job to like take this time to continue learning some things I felt I wasn't getting from being inside an office or being just around tech. And it was connecting to the learning of nature and my environment. And I think it's really important for me. I've learned, like, working in products is to always realize, like, learning is a thing of the whole idea of the self is like the self of me and the self of this world and the self of this universe. And I felt like when everyone was talking about blended learning, I started realizing that my discovery was that it's this need to also recognize, as Olga was saying, that like, I think that was really good reflection coming from just so many things. I mean, this has been an amazing conversation.
Andrea, would you?
Yes, just two quick points. First of all, beside what was already said, I couldn't agree more. I want to say I learned a lot about the technical setup, I must say. So this is really important also for the future, to be able to follow such kind of platforms. And the second point I want to make, which is more a reminder, or really showed me again how interesting and how rewarding it is to bring together people from different areas, from different perspectives, and to learn from each other. And so I very much enjoyed this platform. I think it's really great. And I want to thank you very much to have me here to learn from each other in such an environment. It's very, very, very appreciated. Thank you very much.
Thank you so much, Andrea. It's my role to thank you. Thank you for engaging in this conversation. I personally learned a lot as well. I learned that learning is very diverse, and I made an experience. This was my first moderation ever, and it started with a hybrid one. So I also learned to really smile to screen and to the people next to me, and it was a fantastic experience. Thank you so much. Thank you for your inputs, and we have to stay connected, of course, because we have the Ethical Leadership in Business Talks, which happen every month, and I would like to invite you to that and to continue the conversations, which are actually relevant to business. And also, we at LULB, we want to learn more about how you felt about this experience. So for the online audience, please fill in the survey on Facebook, so we get some opportunity to learn from you as well. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Annika.
Thank you. Thank you for coming.
Thank you.
And have a wonderful afternoon or day, wherever
you
are.
Thank you to everyone. Bye.
Thank you.
Sending love. Thank you.